Hi, I'd like to welcome you to EIB's Home Study Course on Video Game Repairs. My name is Joe Sturtz and I'll be your instructor for this course. What I'd like to do to start off is to unpack the box that we sent you, and let's take a look at all the items that we sent you. First series of items are some supplies that we felt that you might need. The first one is frost test. Frost test we're going to be using later on in the course when we get to the digital section. We're going to use it in order to isolate thermal intermittent problems. The next item is Fluxoff. You might have gotten a can of stripper. It's the same thing under a different label. This is used to remove the rosin on the board after we do some soldering. I would suggest that you don't use it in practicing. It's just a waste of the chemical. The next item is tuner power. This was originally designed for the TV industry, but we use it for cleaning contacts. It's good for one reason, and that is that when you clean the contacts have plating on them. And if you remove that plating, the contacts will oxidize faster than if the plating is there. This chemical will clean the contacts, remove all the oxidation, but will not damage the plating. And that's very, very important. It will also leave a silicon coating on the contacts, and that will help prevent further oxidation. The next item down here in the front is multi-core solder. This solder is a special diameter and has a special rosin inside for use on printed circuit boards. It will not corrode the board. My suggestion is when you replace it with a similar type of solder. It's very important that you don't use acid core solder, which is what plumbers use. The next item is a small pair of cutters. The reason we chose these cutters is the jaws on these cutters will enable you to clip and lift the lead of an IC, which is a troubleshooting technique that we're going to learn in the second half of our course. My suggestion is that you don't use these cutters for anything but cutting electronic component leads. Anything else will damage the jaws and then you won't be able to cut the IC leads. The next two items over here are alignment tools. These two alignment tools are used for adjusting the coils that we'll find in our color and black and white monitors. They are very special tools. If they become worn, you should replace them. If you don't replace them when they're worn, they will break the core of the coils and you'll end up with a stuck coil. We've included in the kit also this small screwdriver with a pocket clip. This way you can keep this in your pocket so it's handy. When you remove ICs, you'll need this to pry them up out of the printed circuit board. The next item we're going to be using when we study monitors. This is a high voltage probe and can measure voltages as high as 40,000 volts. Most monitors use voltages in the high voltage section of 12,000 to 25,000. This meter will be more than adequate for our purposes and will enable you to determine accurately if you have enough high voltage to give a good picture. The next item is a solder sucker or solder pullet. This item will be used for removing the molten solder when we desolder ICs out of the circuit board. Each IC, when you heat up the joint, you have to pull the solder away from the lead so that afterwards we'll be able to pull the IC up out of the board without damaging it. That technique will be taught at the end of this tape. We've included two manuals in this portion of the course, and one of them is a TTL cookbook. This cookbook contains all the information on the logic blocks that will be studied in the second half of the course. My suggestion is that you start studying this now. This way when we get to it, it will be more familiar with. The last item is a GE substitution manual. This manual is used to look up transistors that you want to replace. We'll be going into that later in this tape when we cover transistors. We'll go into how to look them up for replacement purposes. Now that we've gotten that out of the way, I'd like to get some ground rules down. That is, this course covers a lot of material in a very fast amount of time. And if you have any questions, obviously you can't ask them to me directly, But we've made provisions for an 800 telephone line, so you can call us toll-free and ask any questions that will come up. Now, that number is available to you in the front of the manual that comes with this tape. And our business hours are 9 to 5, Tuesday through Saturday. We're closed Sundays and Mondays. So remember, feel free, if you have any questions whatsoever, any problems, we're there all the time. If I'm not in, my secretary will take your message, and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. At this time, we'd like to start studying basic electronics, and that's covered in the manual that came with the tape. And if you'll now open up to page 1, we'll start with basic electronics. Okay, let's get started now with basic electronics. All materials in nature are made up of atoms. And if we draw an atom on the board, an atom is made up of the nucleus, and the outer rings, which have electrons on them. Inside the nucleus, we have neutrons, which have no charge, and we have protons that are positively charged. And the electrons around the outside are shells, and those electrons have a negative charge. And that interaction, opposite charges attract, so the electrons are kept in orbits around the nucleus of the atom. Now there are certain atoms, and those atoms we call conductors, where the electrons in the outer shell are easily moved from one end to the next. So if we impress a force against this atom, what will happen is an electron from here will go into the outer ring on the next atom over, and so forth and so on down the line. This atom will now be negatively charged, and it will push an electron onto the outer ring of the next atom. This flow or movement of electrons is called electricity or current. And that's what we're studying. Now, when we have a wire, a wire is made up of metal atoms, usually copper or something similar to that. And the atoms in copper will easily be moved down the wire. So if we apply a pressure and an electricity, we call that pressure voltage. And voltage is measured in volts. We can cause these electrons to move down the wire. Now there is one other term that we have to get straight, and that is volume, or the number of electrons that pass a given slice or cross-section of the wire at any given time. That term, or volume, is called current. And current is measured in amps. So now we have two terms that describe the movement of electricity or electrons down this wire, and that is the voltage, which is the pressure or force pushing the electrons down the wire, and the current, which is the amount of electrons that pass any given point in a given amount of time. Now, we've developed an analogy that makes this a little easier to understand, and that is called our water analogy. We'll be referring to that quite often. You'll find this in your manual also, and catch it while we're covering it right. And that's if we took a pipe containing water,